Morning, evening to the country office colleagues who are on the line, I believe. So welcome to you too. Welcome to our Fish Learning Hour. So an initiative that our comms team have put in place. So we're very, very pleased today to have Rahul Bhan, who's the executive director for Audit Asia, who is our internal audit firm. We have a great partnership with Rahul and his team, and we've just spent the morning, the risk management steering committee, we just spent the whole morning and early afternoon on risk management. So the next session that Rahul is going to present and share learnings and wisdom around internal controls and fraud is part of our overall risk management framework. So thank you very much, Rahul, for coming down to Penang and providing this session for World Fish. So over to you.
Thanks, Zarina. Good afternoon, everybody, and good morning, good evening to people around country offices. Fraud internal controls, it's a very interesting subject because we get to deal with this on our day-to-day life, both personally and professionally. And why it is very important at World Fish, because our donors have and we have a zero tolerance towards fraud. So we do not accept anything about fraud, anything happening. And then it becomes very important. We need to know, we have to understand what is fraud, why it happens, and how can we control it. So anybody can tell me what is the, I know it's just after lunch we are here, so I'll keep asking certain questions to keep you busy. Can anybody tell me what do they understand with fraud? I mean, their understanding, I don't want a definition which will come here. Yes? You want to say something? Okay. So, my presentation is broken down into, four parts. So from the first part, we will talk about what is fraud, what are the elements of fraud, the triangle, why the fraud happens, various types of fraud, fraud in CGIS system, what are the indicators of fraud, the red flags, and what are the consequences of fraud. There is a definition of fraud by the Institute of Internal Auditors. Any illegal act characterized by deceit, concealment, or violation of trust. These acts are not dependent upon the threat of violence or physical force. Fraud are perpetrated by parties and organizations to obtain money, property, or services, to avoid payment or loss of services, or to secure personal or business advantage. I mean, this is from the audit perspective, the definition is, but a very simple one, I would say, is another definition which I found and which I researched, says fraud is any intentional act, so you do with an intention, or omission designed to deceive others, so deceive means cheating others, resulting in a victim suffering a loss, so the other party suffers a loss, and the perpetrator achieving a gain. So you do an illegal act, you deceive somebody where you gain and other party bears a loss, because that's how it happens, and that is a fraud. And it is characterized by intentional deception or misrepresentation. Any questions on this? I think we all agree what fraud definition is. Okay, next is the elements of fraud. So what are the elements? What constitute a fraud? It's a material false statement. Knowledge of the person who's making that statement that the statement is false when it was uttered. Reliance on the false statement by the victim. So victim believes on the false information. And there are damages resulting from the victim's reliance on the false statement. So the party who's relying suffers actually the damage. Clear? The fraud triangle. Now, why fraud happens? Fraud actually, there are different definitions. There is a fraud diamond as well, but we'll stick to the old definition of fraud triangle, which why a person commits fraud. So on there are three aspects why a person commits fraud. One is the pressure. Say I need money, there are financial pressure. My personal habits, I do gambling, drugs, alcohol, for which the money what I earn is not sufficient. There are work-related factors. I am overworked or underpaid, not promoted, career pressures. I need a financial result, so I am not getting a raise in my salary. Let me do fraud and let me earn money by, you know, wrong means. In a business or in an organization, it could be they can also get involved. In our case, it could be our partners who can get involved, and that could be that we have selected a partnership which has high debts. They have credit problems, working capital problems, so they try to cheat WorldFish to get more money out of it. So that is the pressure a person has when or an organization to commit frauds. And then you say you want to do a fraud, but you just can't commit until unless you get opportunities, right? So what are these opportunities? Opportunities are poor internal controls. For example, now I do a travel a lot. I fake my per diems. I give my travel claims. How? Because I need money. So that's the money part, is the pressure. Now, how do I get an opportunity? I know nobody checks my travel claims, or when I submit, they just get approved. So there is a lack of internal control which is happening. In one case, it has even passed. I got an extra money. So that is what is called an opportunity. And there is low fraud awareness. So as a manager, I trust all my people. I don't even think that somebody can fraud. And that's again an opportunity. Treat fraudster with leniency. So if I find somebody who has done a fraud, I become very lenient. Okay, no problem. We'll see it next time. So there is no action taken. That's again an opportunity to fraudster. Rapid turnover of employees, use of many banks, weak subordinate personnel, absence of mandatory vacation. So somebody doesn't want to take a leave. Somebody is handling cash and they continue to handle cash. They don't want to go on leave. They don't want anybody else to take charge because they had been doing some fraudulent activities. So this is more on the opportunity a person or organization gets. And then the third part of the triangle, why a person commit fraud, is the rationalization. So you do a fraud and you justify why I'm doing it. For example, I'm only borrowing the money and will pay back when I get it in future. Nobody gets hurt, so let me just do the fraud. We are taking money, we are cheating, let us cheat. Who's getting hurt? Nobody. The organization treats me unfairly and owes me. I work very hard, I work day and night, but I am not paid much. So I should act in a fraudulent activities to get money in a different way. It's for a good purpose. I need to do fraud because I have to donate this somewhere. There's a purpose. So it's only temporary until operations improves. That's for the organization, the partners, for example. So you have a pressure to do something, you have an opportunity, and the third is you can justify it. No thief will ever say that I'm doing wrong. They will have a pressure because they don't have a job, for example. So there's a financial pressure, there are expenses at home. A thief will also have an opportunity. Oh, there are no CCTV cameras, I can go and steal it. And third, the thief has to also justify, right, that, you know, what he's doing is good for the living. They will always justify. So this is very important for us to understand why the frauds happen. And this triangle actually explains in a very nice way. Anybody has any questions so far? Even from the country offices, if they have questions, they can type it and we can take it immediately. Now there are four, there are many types of fraud, but within the CGIS system, I have put these in four boxes. So one is corrupt practices, offering, giving, receiving, or soliciting directly or indirectly anything of value to influence improperly the actions of another party. This type of practice is more in the procurement side. So we do, you know, we want to get selected as a partner, or we are selling something to World Fish and one of the supplier. We know there is a tender, so we try to, you know, to go to the procurement head. Can you give us this business? We will give you a 10% cut, for example. Or we give you a gift, which is not in the nature of gift, but more than a gift. So that is the corrupt practices. Then there is a fraudulent practices, which means an act or omission, including a misrepresentation, that knowingly or recklessly misleads or attempts to mislead a party to obtain a financial or other benefit in order to avoid an obligation. For example, there is a tender process, four suppliers are in line, but one of the supplier does not meet the technical criteria. So they do a fake thing where they include, they misrepresent, they don't have a competent person in their team, but they try to show fake CVs. So this is a fraudulent practice. Then there is a collusive practices, where two people can combine, and so it's an arrangement between two or more parties designed to achieve an improper purpose, including influencing improperly the actions of another party. So say you have a manager and subordinate. Now as per the policy, you are not allowed to do certain things, but manager says, can you do this? I will just approve, and nobody sees that, right? So two people, and I am the one to check, so you are most welcome to do it, and we both share the benefits out of it. So that's a collusive practices. And in an organization, if that happens, it's not very very easy to, you know, identify when four people collude. Say we have an office in our country office where we have only five people strength, and all five get together and they share the money. How can we identify, unless until we have some other internal controls? So I will come to those controls in this last part. So this is a collusion. Then there is a coercive practice, which means impairing or harming or threatening to impair or harm directly or indirectly and any party or the property of the party to influence improperly the actions of the party. Coercive, I do not see prevailing that much in our type of organization, but they can still happen. Somebody can, you know, ask you, if you don't do this, I can do this, you know. It's a threatening. So these are the four type, I mean, they have various type of fraud, but this is the four where we have grouped in, and most of the fraud, I would say all the frauds would fall in these four boxes. I will skip this one. Now this is very important slide. This talks about types of fraud in the CGIS system, which means all the CGIS centers may face typically, these are the types of fraud which normally happen, and these are into two parts, the financial frauds and the scientific fraud. So we can look in detail. I would read that because I know it's very important. Financial fraud is acceptance of bribes or kickbacks for allocating or renewing contracts. So the contract could be any, your travel agency, your supplier, and you accept bribe to renew or to give them the new contract. Embezzlement of money and falsification of financial records to cover up the act, thus making detection difficult. So for example, what I have seen in the system is you pay money to an employee, and then later, because you are the manager, you write off that. So you never recover that money from the employee. That's also a fraud. claim service submitted for services or goods not actually provided to the center. So you have fake bills, and for something what you have not provided, even for the procurement of any goods, you say you bill them for 10 items but you only provide them 5 items, so you make money out of it. That is fraud. False travel expense claims. This is the most important thing. I think this is the maximum which has happened in these centers, because our travel claim, a lot of people travel, and travel claims are such where it's much more easy to fake it. Lot of centers have started per diem instead of actual, you know, bills, because in the actual situation these people get fake invoices, and then the centers are more vulnerable to the frauds. Then unauthorized or illegal manipulation of IT networks, operating or application systems, or unauthorized diversion of funds or benefit to individuals, theft of consumable stores and fuel supplies, theft or misuse of centers' assets such as vehicles, workshops and laboratories. This is also very quite prevalent. I know I was in Tanzania for another center. The employees were given 4x4 vehicles, but they were misusing those vehicles because that was for office work, but they were using it in the for the game drives in the forest areas to see the animals. So now HR complained to me, how can we control? So yeah, because I know there has to be a control, but people had been given a car for official purpose, but they were doing that, and that resulted in more repairs to the vehicles and a lot of repair expenses. So again, then this is also a fraud. Actually, what you are doing, something you're not supposed to do. Office gives you a laptop, you use it for, you know, installing certain programs which are you are not supposed to do, or you do something, some other business online through your office computer. So these are few things which also amount to fraud. Theft of experimental station produce which would otherwise be sold by the center for income. Yeah, this is very important. This also happens in few centers where in World Fish, for example, you may be selling the fishes you have for research work. Sometimes you are allowed to sell only to the employees. You are not allowed to sell to the outside world because of the status of diplomatic and not-for-profit status. But certain people do. You are selling other stuff. That's also fraud. Abuse for personal gain of duty-free privileges provided to centers. This is very, very important, because as expats, the IRS in most of these centers get some duty-free privileges. I know I am working at IVMI. As an IRS, I get a privilege to get a duty-free liquor. Now, the liquor rate in duty-free is less than half of the market price. One of the IRS employees was actually given a warning because his subordinate used to take liquor and he was selling in one of his hotels, and the custom department actually caught that, and it was a bad reputation for whole of the organization. So when people come to you, they have a duty-free privileges of importing a car or other white goods. You have to be really see whether it's for your own use, because what is the purpose? It should not be that benefit or you get should not be abused. Otherwise, it amounts again to fraud. Intentional and improper related party activities in which one party receives some benefit not obtainable in an arm's length transaction, relating to a sale to staff of center's asset no longer required. I think that's explainable, where centers sell their old stuff, say laptops and other, at a incredibly low prices, then we have to question. That is again a loss to the organization. Recruitment of consultants. Now, that is something we all can relate. I see all the centers, that's a big problem. I know this person will be, you know, my consultant. In one case, I don't want to name anything, one person, very senior person, wanted his wife to be a consultant. She had been a housewife for 17 years. They say the amount will be $800 a day $40,000 would be her remuneration, and everybody questions that. And ultimately, of course, one thing we have to see that no information can be hidden. And being a organization, a smaller setup, there is a zero tolerance, and we all will be caught once because the rumors spread very quickly. So that is a social pressure, how you are going to face it. So these are few instances of financial fraud which I have noted in the CG centers. And on the financial perspective, then we have scientific frauds. I have no personal experience with the scientific frauds, but I think the scientists can say more here. Deliberate attempts to falsify or misrepresent data. Analyzing and reporting only part of collected data. Honorary authorship report attributed to authors who did not take part in it. Fake interviews conducted by assistant to researchers. Data never gathered up but made up data. Data and IP theft from somebody else. Data copied on non-compliance with legislation on data protection. So you steal the data. Giving credits, data gathering attributed to those that did not take part of, in it. Duplicate submission or permission. Test copied from others without giving proper attribution. So there can be many more, but this is more or less the scientific frauds which we probably may come across and notice in our day-to-day working. Any question? Anybody want to contribute any other fraud apart from this? What they see in a day-to-day life, because it will be learning for me also. You want to say Zarina something? Okay. Now, what are the fraud risks? I know this morning we had been doing the session on the fraud risk. We have a risk of fraud in each and every process. We looked at the financial frauds, we looked at scientific frauds. But in each of the process, which is HR, finance, operational, partnerships, compliance, research, we have a fraud risk. So what I have done is I have identified certain risks. So in a finance process, it could be disbursement, reimbursements and expense claims schemes, overstatement of expenses, overstatement of your per diems, cash and check fraud schemes, financial statement and cost reporting schemes. So for example, one of the fraud which may happen is your donor allows only a certain amount of overhead or a certain percentage of overhead. Now you try to play with it to extract more and more, you know, or you try to justify that this is a overhead cost which is recoverable, or part of overhead cost you make it direct cost. So that can happen. Investment schemes, tax frauds. You have a diplomatic status or an immunity from taxes only in the headquarters, not in each and every country. In certain countries you may not have, and you have people working but they don't pay taxes. HR processes, nepotism, bribery in the recruitment process, payroll schemes, inflated consultancy cost, abuse of staff loans, misrepresentation, and benefit frauds. I think it's explainable. Operational support, what could be fraud risk? Corruption schemes in procurement, bid rigging, the bids you make for winning any deal, conflict of interest. So I have my brother, I have my wife, I have my sister, I appoint them. Misappropriation of assets, fictitious vendor schemes. So in fact, in one center it was noted that one of the main vendor was actually, there was no vendor, it was an employee who created a fake ID of a vendor, and all the deals were through that. And once it was discovered, there was no address, the phone number of the employee and the vendor was same. Overbilling by vendors, straightforward, fictitious deliveries of goods and services, IT fraud schemes. Within partnerships, which we have so many, we can have falsified claims from partners, falsified outputs, which is also which can be which is very easy. In fact, I was in Bangladesh last month. They were supposed to have like one of the projects, Ecofish, about 490 villages. I am not sure if they have really done, you know, the benefit has gone to all the 490 villages. So they partners can also falsify. It is not actual, is maybe 400, we don't know. So we need to have checks and balances in place, which will come later, but this is what can happen. So there's a risk: misappropriation of assets, conflict of interest in partner selection. So we only select the partners which we want to, or we have got a bribe, or somebody is our relative. On the compliances, abuse of diplomatic privileges, which I just mentioned, the liquor thing, for example, bribery to obtain work permits or government license, misrepresentation. On the research, plagiarism, falsification, fabrication of data, false statement conclusions, false representation, false academic credentials, false fabricated reviews. So these are variety of fraud risk in each areas. Now, the most important, other important thing is indicators of fraud. How do we identify that there is a fraud or not? Because everything seems to us is okay, but if a fraud has happened, there will be one or two things which will be missing. Key document is missing. So I have a travel claim, but I see a boarding pass missing, or you know, some invoice missing, something. So person may have falsified and then they try to take out those documents or create documents. No separation of financial duties. So you have no segregation of duties. One person is doing preparing the vouchers, approving it and making payment. So that amount, there is a fraud risk, and there could be a fraud there. Accounting system in disarray. So whatever information the accounting system gives are not correct. You can say system error, but it gives an opportunity to the person to carry out a fraud because they know it won't be detected. Lack of policies that establish control. So we don't have policies in place. Inadequate monitoring to ensure these controls work as intended. So we have policies in place, but there's no monitoring. So how you can do a monitoring? Surprise checks by the management. We can have an internal audit. We can have other audits or reviews. Ineffective accounting, IT or internal audit staff. Documentation that is photocopied or lacking essential information. Anybody can tell me why photocopy is normally not allowed? Because you can claim multiple times. So if you have an original, you claim once, but if you have a photocopy, every year you just change the date and put that claim again, right? Unusual employee behavior. Suddenly you see an employee started wearing Rolex watches, buys a big car, you can see this is a red flag, you know. So these are all indicators that something is not right. So it doesn't mean that fraud is always there, but it gives an indication, and then you can investigate it further. Tips or complaints about fraud. So whistleblower, which is again a very important instrument to identify if the fraud is happening or not. Lack of established code of ethical conduct. Unwilling to share responsibility to manage relationship with a vendor or partner or another third company. So for example, you have a vendor and for Worldfish, and you say, I will only deal with this vendor. No, I don't want any other employee to deal with this. You know, then that should give a suspicion why this person only want to get involved. And somebody comes to you and they say, well, when it comes to the payment, always this vendor is a priority and not based on the cycle for the payment. So they try to give favors. So these are things actually indicate that something is not right. It does not necessarily mean that this is a fraud, but it gives a tip which should be investigated further. The other indicators are poorly documented, needs assessment for purchases. request for urgent purchases, because in urgent purchases you don't go for three quotations or the normal process. This is very urgent, we need it now. And this happens in all the centers, in all the country offices. I always put audit remark on audit issue, why don't you plan your purchases, why don't you have procurement plan? Because a person will come, no, we need to hire, even in the HR perspective for a consultant, we need to hire this person tomorrow. This is the one who is selected. HR says, give us few days, we want to go through the normal process, but you know, the scientist will come, no, we will not allow that. So that is again one of the indicators that something is not right. Purchase specification too narrow or precise, so that only one supplier can qualify. So when we are looking for some products, we try to use the qualification of a supplier who's my friend, and we try to narrow down and that happens a lot. Subjective criteria for evaluating vendor compliance with specification, so you have a different criteria for different vendor. Vendor contract split into multiple tenders just below the threshold for competitive bidding. So in WorldFish you have a criteria, I think over $3,000, up to $3,000, if I'm right, Sarina, that you don't invite tenders, right? So if a tender is for $5,000, we split it into two, so that we don't have to go and invite for tenders. So that is another where we are bypassing the normal process. Contract amount with vendors just below the threshold for senior management review. So everything, for example, over $10,000 should be reviewed by DG. But if I see that there's a conflict of interest or there's some fraud, I don't want this to be seen by the DG, I will split that so that there's no review by DG. Limited bid advertising for purchases. So I want to advertise only very in a limited way. Drastic changes in pricing from previous contract or from market rates. Unusual bid patterns indicating possible collusion. So these are all the red flags. There are many, many more. Unjustified sole source contracts. This happens a lot in consultancies. No, it's the only one who can do this. We don't have any other person in the whole world. I mean, think from that perspective, is it right? Bidding processes involve direct negotiation with suppliers. Unjustified change orders to contract after the award. So you award a contract, then you change. So that is also not right. Goods not matching the sample provided with the bid. So what you asked for, you bid it, what the price was, and you get an inferior quality. Goods with imminent or past expiry dates. Unexpected staff departures. Resistance to adopt automation. We want only manual process, we don't want to automate. Big construction refurbishment projects, significant adverse changes, staff redundancies. So yeah, repeat contract, the first one, repeat contract awards to same suppliers, or the lowest price bidder being bypassed for a costlier supplier. So these all are indicators. Now, any questions in this? I think this is a pretty exhaustive list, yes. You see something suspicious happening. You go home, you smell something from the fire, smoke. Oh, there is a fire, you investigate, you don't see it, but you smell the smoke. It's coming from somewhere, let's investigate. So this is, you see, I mean somebody, these are so many, the behavior of your subordinate changes. There could be many things. Somebody comes to you and asks, can we do it this way? And this is not right. This is not a normal behavior of this person. Why is he behaving in such a different way? They want to hide something. I mean, that happens in everybody's home. Your children can do that. Your relatives can do that. What does he want from me? That is how you are going to catch. That's the red flags. We see it's not that only one red flag does not mean that it's a fraud, but that gives you enough you know, motivation to investigate. And if you can't, you need to hire, you know, experts to do that. Okay. Yeah, Tana, you have something? Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
Would you mind elaborating a little bit more on how unexpected staff departure can be an indicator of fraud?
See, that is a very good question. If I have done something really wrong, for I had been doing for many, many years, now I feel it's time, it may get detected. I say, let me leave before it gets detected and my reputation is spoiled. You know, so that is somebody who had been doing very well, had been there for 10 years, suddenly says, now I'm going, and you don't see any real reason. It's one of the indicators. I'm not saying that necessarily there will be a fraud, but it can be, and it is one of the red flags which you should investigate. Okay. Say, what happened in ICRISAT? I mean, that's a public news. Person had been defrauding for last 10 years. Okay, he didn't move out. He was asked to move. That was also delayed. But sometimes a finance director says, now I want to move. Somebody who's getting a handsome salary, there is no real reason, but still want to quit the job. You know, so has that person done something wrong? So that's anything? Anybody else? Okay, we move to next. What are the consequences of fraud? In our CGIS centers, the consequences you get, there is a business continuity issue. Funding stops. Reputation goes down. Right? So if WorldFish gets involved and donors know, will the donor fund us? No. If the donor fund don't fund us, will the organization run? No, we have to put the law, we have to close it down. So I put it, you know, direct financial loss, of course. Donor stops the funding. Lost time to rectify the problem, because we have to rectify. There is a cost associated to that. Diversion of management resources. So suddenly, if we see fraud happen, HR runs, internal auditor runs, you know, and all our, we could have done something better, but our resources are diverted. Cost of external resources. Now, once fraud happens, we have to report to CGIA. They have a template. Their time is spent because they have to report to donors. Sometimes we have the bilaterals, we have direct projects. We have to report ourselves to the donors. Donor reputation impact. So there is a big impact on the reputation from donors. Negative impact on staff morale. So staff also morale suffers. Possible loss of valuable staff members, because once a fraud happens, then many more people actually get victimized due to it. Loss of management confidence. So if my one country office does not do well, we have a fraud management, first question management will come, can we close this office? So that is another one. Consequential financial loss, unwanted attention and intervention from international oversight agencies, donors, governments. So these are the ones. Next part is the fraud risk integration in our internal audit strategy. I will not go in detail, because that is how the internal auditors, as internal auditors, how do we work. I thought it's good to share the slides so that you know what we do. Fraud, it's divided into four parts again. Fraud risk integration into the internal audit strategy, which we carry out. Fraud risk management strategy, fraud risk responsibilities as per the Institute of Internal Auditor Standards, and fraud risk assessment. How do we assess a fraud risk? So that will also be useful when we are doing the risk assessment. Internal auditors, what as an internal auditors I had to do? We should review whether center risk assessment adequately addresses the risk of fraud across the organization? Has the center assessed the risk across all its regional offices, all its departments, all its projects? Internal auditors evaluate risk faced by the organization based on the audit plans with the appropriate testing. So we, when the centers have their own risk assessment, they identify fraud risk. As internal auditors, we evaluate the risks. Fraud risk to be considered in the assessment of internal control design. So when we prepare the design, we also see the fraud risk of the at the center, and also in determination of audit steps to be performed. In addition, internal auditors also assist management in establishing effective fraud prevention measures by knowing organization strength, weakness, and providing consulting expertise. So we can assist the management how, what controls you can have in place to prevent fraud in future. Then we can also do surprise audits. So insisting audits with no notice to the auditees. I think that we have in WorldFish, we have already started since last year. As per the board's request, we have done a surprise audit last year. Preventing and detecting fraud and corruption is not primary role of internal audit. It's like a disclaimer, because that is not, don't expect internal auditors only to find frauds. You are in a best position with the indicators, red flags, that you will have a smell of if something is happening is wrong. And then you can ask internal auditors or other expert to, you know, if it's an IT related fraud, for example, somebody is using computer. So you can ask the computer experts to decode the hard disk, for example, and find out if there are certain fraudulent stuff there. Fraud risk management strategy is mainly on prevention. So how WorldFish should have its own strategy on fraud risk management. So prevention means you need to have a fraud policy. What is your policy? Your fraud prevention plan, and which should include fraud risk assessment and mitigation. Prevention, then you have detection. So for how do you detect frauds? Internal controls, internal audits, external audits, reporting structures like whistleblower mechanism. So somebody finds something wrong happening, there's a whistleblower policy, they can call up or they can write anonymous or with their names to the headquarters, to audit committee chair or board, this is what is happening is not correct. Then once you have that information, you do an investigation. And after investigation, you should have a response policy. How do you respond to that fraud? Now, fraud has been, there is a policy, but still it happened, it was detected, we investigated, now what needs to be done? What action should we take? Should we ask the employees to leave who were involved? How do we recover money? How do we put in the controls in place that this does not repeat? Any questions on this? Pretty straightforward. So I will not go in detail. These are the internal audit standards. So we do have these are standards which I have to comply with. These the ones which related to fraud risk responsibilities of the auditors. Again, I said they are not complete. Internal auditor is not the only one responsible to detect all the frauds, but based on these responsibilities, we do have some capabilities, and when we do our audit, to smell if there is a fraud happening. This is how you do the assessment of fraud risk. Identify relevant risk factors, identify potential fraud scheme, map your existing control to potential fraud schemes and identify gaps, test operating effectiveness of fraud prevention and detection controls, document and report the fraud risk assessment. So then we move to the third section. What do we do when we identify fraud? Has anybody identified any fraud or experienced any fraud? Somebody? Nobody? So we are a very clean organization. Good, very good. This is what do we do when we identify fraud? What next? Because once you identify fraud, don't take it very easy. The reason being is, as I said, if you go to the initial triangle, the fraudster will never claim that he or she has done something wrong. They will always try to justify. The case probably would end up in a court when an employee is dismissed. So we need to have proper paperwork, proper investigation. We also need to see that the people who are not involved don't get implicated in such things. Morale is high, because if you remove one person is identified and asked to leave, the morale of the team or motivation goes down. So we have to be very careful. Sometimes we also need to be sensitive. Somebody has done a fraud, but we know that person has a family. We want to get rid of that person, but we want to do in a very ethical way that it doesn't hurt other members of that person's family. Fraud prevention, fraud investigation steps. So when you identify fraud, you first don't know whether it is a fraud or not. Then second thing, what you don't know is how to quantify that fraud. Is it $1 million fraud or a $10 fraud, or for example, you have a fire at home, you don't know how much it has spread, right? Based on that, you will ask, okay, I take a bucket of water and douse it, or I need a fire extinguisher, or I should call a fire brigade, so that's what it is. So you preserve an evidence, and based on a preliminary inquiry and involvement, this is in case if the auditor, as an auditor, if I detect a fraud somewhere, I should be speaking to the corporate service director or the DDG or the director. Then we organize an investigation that establish whether fraud has been committed and the extent of fraud. So the quantification of fraud, and a report of the investigation to be provided to the director general, the DG, and the audit committee, who will follow the disciplinary process as appropriate. So this is mainly from the internal auditor's perspective. But as an employee, I think if you discover a fraud, either if it's your own boss, you report through the whistleblower mechanism. For example, if it's one of your subordinates, then you don't have to be afraid of the whistleblower protection. You can just tell the top management, and then they can the management team, they can start the investigation to the extent how do we need to understand what is the extent of fraud. And internal auditors, again a disclaimer from the internal audit perspective, we are not expected to act as a professional investigator. In most cases we can do that, but in certain cases, for example, it's a IT related fraud where we do not have that expertise, you need to get IT experts. If it's related to the hard disk decoding, then you need to have those kind of experts. All staff accused of fraud are innocent until proven guilty. This is very important thing, because there is a question, what if there are only circumstantial evidences available? This is a, you can't say person started wearing Rolex, coming in the Maybach of Mercedes, and he has done some fraud or she has done some fraud. No. Till they are, these are just circumstantial evidence which says, okay, your salary is this, how did you get these kind of assets? So that's questions, but then it's not till they are proven guilty. But then these are the red flags, so which should provide you enough evidence to start some kind of investigation or preliminary inquiry. Fraud investigation, the steps are gathering evidence through surveillance, interviews, written statements, documenting and preserving evidence, considering legal rules of evidence and business use of evidence, because it might be possible that you have identified the fraud but the person denies and then they take you to the court. So the evidence has to be such that it can be used in the court. For example, in the morning we just discussed on when we are interviewing people, we have recorded the interview by not telling the person that we are recording. Is that admissible in the court of law? In Europe, it is not. I mean, country to country differs. But for example, in Europe, if you are there, you have a CCTV camera and you have not put the board, there are CCTV cameras in place. Any recording from that cannot be used as an evidence. That's in Netherlands. So some countries have different laws. So we have to see what the legal laws are there. Determine the extent of fraud, very, very important, because then you will know, whether you should be recovering that or it's a very low amount, what you need to do. Determine the technique used to perpetrate the fraud, so how that fraud has happened. Actually, I had an opportunity to see in one of the centers, country office, how the fraud happened. That person showed me. And I was very surprised, because with my own eye, I could not have detected it. So, but now I can see, okay, it can happen also this way. So next time I will be more careful, you know. Evaluating the cause of the fraud. So we have the triangle. Remember the first slides we saw? So those triangles, we can always, there will, the, you know, the cause of the fraud, can you can relate to that triangle, where it's very easy. And then identifying the perpetrators. Is there any question from, okay, when it's finished, okay. Then we talk about internal controls. Internal controls are the controls we have in place to mitigate the frauds. So I'll talk about three lines of defense. The internal control framework from COSO, which is a committee of sponsoring organizations. And from fraud perspective, what could be the internal controls? So three lines of defense. Every organization has these three lines of defense. The first line of defense that things don't happen is the management control and internal control measures. Which have to be in place. So you have internal control. Somebody will review your work. If there is an expense, one person will do the expense, one person will prepare the vouchers, one will approve, and there will be another person who is recording that in the OCS. Then second line of defense is that you have a financial controller who produces MIS reports, who studies the behavior. Okay, this has been my trend, why it has gone up, why it has gone down. You have a physical security security or theft related frauds. You have a person at the gate, a security guard. You have risk management in place, so where you identify what can go wrong in future. Quality aspect in terms of your deliveries of your reports or of your scientific results. Inspection compliances. So this is a second line of defense. And the third line of defense is an internal audit. So the auditors also come in place. So these are the three defenses which any organization will have to control the fraudulent activities or wrong activities, I would. Now the COSO framework, COSO is a committee of sponsoring organizations of Treadway Commission. It's a joint initiative of five professional associations based in the US. This framework is actually widely accepted all over the world. And the COSO's role was to provide thought leadership to executive management and governance entities on critical aspects of organizational governance, business ethics, internal controls, risk management, fraud and financial reporting. COSO has established a common internal control model against which companies and organizations may assess their control systems. What is the definition of internal control as per COSO? It is a process affected by an entity's board of trustees, management and other personnel designed to provide reasonable assurance regarding achievement of objectives relating to operations, reporting and compliances. There are five components, 17 core principles. I will not go in detail. Actually, this is the framework they have. But what we will try to understand here is what kind of controls we can put in place as a first line of defense to avoid these frauds. So the first control, which is a requirement, is there should be a commitment to integrity and ethical values. We have code of ethics, right? How many of you are aware of code of ethics here? Worldfish? Nobody? Yeah, okay, good. Zarina, I think this should be taken seriously. Code of ethics, because normally you would have signed when you joined, but have you read after that? Code of conduct, okay. Sorry, right word, code of conduct. How many have you of you have read that? 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, 6 people. When you probably joined, you would have a requirement, but after you have joined, have you read any time? No. Okay. So you need to have a training in that. And annually, you know, Zarina, as an action point, we can note it, that annually, I think that's very important, because what ethics are we supposed, because there's a culture and ethics risk. I mean, this morning we have identified that risk. So we have to ensure that, you know, we all are at same line when it comes to ethics and values. Board's independence from management and oversight of the development and performance of internal control. Management establishes with board oversight structures, reporting lines, and appropriate authorities and responsibilities in the pursuit of objectives. Commitment to attract, develop, and retain competent individuals in alignment with objectives, so you have right people in right place. Accountability of individuals for their internal control responsibilities in pursuit of objectives. Risk assessment, what you need to have in place is organization specifies objectives with sufficient clarity to enable the identification and assessment of risk relating to the objectives. So you have, you are free to identify the risk. There is an atmosphere which enables you to identify those risks. The organization identifies risk to the achievement of its objective across the entity and analyzes risk. So this morning we discussed a criteria on how to analyze the risk as a basis for determining how these risks to be managed. That will very soon will be in place. We are working towards it. The organization considers the potential for fraud in assessing risk to the achievement of objectives. So that's also underway here. The organization identifies and assesses changes that could significantly impact the system of internal control. So if there are any changes, you know, we need to identify what can change our control system. Control activities. The organization selects and develops control activities that contribute to the mitigation of risks, to the achievement of objectives to an acceptable levels. This is part of risk management process. The organization selects and develops general control activities and technology in support of achievement of objectives. So the IT controls which are in place, for example, you have a password. So there is a 4I principle, person who inserts the data or who fills in the data is not the one to approve that. Organization deploys control activities through policies that establish what is expected and procedures that put policies into action. So there are different policies, frameworks. So these are all control activities. Next, on information and communication, what are the control activities as per the COSO framework? The organization obtains or generates and uses relevant quality information to support the functioning of internal controls. The organization internally communicates information, including objectives and responsibilities for internal control, necessary to support the functioning of internal control. The organization communicates with external parties regarding matter affecting the functioning of internal controls. So, for example, publicly available annual reports in this case, in the 14, number 14, we have regular updates on intranet. with regards to internal communications, access to the organization policies, number 13, financial reports, the dashboard, the internal MIS reporting. So these are all variety of controls. And the final list is on monitoring activities. So how you monitor what's happening in the organization. The organization selects, develops, and performs ongoing or separate evaluation to ascertain whether the components of internal control are present and functioning. So in this case, you use your external audits. We have your internal audit reviews. There are regulatory reviews, possibly by the government. There are donor audits, donor reviews. Then there could be other internal oversight activities. So this is how you monitor. Then the organization evaluates and communicates internal control deficiencies in a timely manner to those parties responsible for taking corrective actions, including senior management and the board of directors, also CGIAR in cases. Then you have a board report, audit committee reports, you have reporting to the CGIAR as well. Okay, any questions? I think that's it. This is more on the fraud prevention. I believe you all have the slides for this. This is more explaining more in detail. For example, you can have password controls, you have a forensic analysis, fraudulent activity to look out for. Fraudulent vendors usually show a very high year over growth. So these are various type of indicators which you can prevent. There can be surprise audits, you can have job rotations, there can should be mandatory vacations for people in the key positions. So in a finance process, what kind of controls you can have, HR process, IT process, you will use when you are doing the risk mitigations. Most of these will come, you know, in your mitigation part, right? Governance process, procurement process, and